Good morning and a very happy and blessed fifth Sunday of Pentecost. We will begin, please, with hymn 390, Praise to the Lord.
Humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore you double. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is number 145, verses 8 through 15. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and of great kindness. The Lord is loving to everyone, and his compassion is over all his works. All your works praise you, O Lord, and your faithful servants bless you. They make known the glory of your kingdom and speak of your power. That the peoples may know of your power and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion endures throughout all ages. The Lord is faithful in all his words and merciful in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all those who fall. He lifts up those who are bowed down. Our epistle this morning is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it is to be the law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my innermost self, but I see in my members another law at war, the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from the body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
according to Matthew.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus said, "To what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another, 'We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn.' For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners,' yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." At that time Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise unto you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Every 3 years when this particular gospel rolls around, it is a challenge to know what to say about it, really for two reasons. One is it's obscure, and second, it comes in three very distinct pieces, and it's not immediately clear what those three pieces have to do with one another. So, now that I've managed expectations, let's see where we can go with this. The first piece ends with, "Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." In this first piece, we know that Jesus is being frustrated. Jesus is impatient. He is being tough on the Jews of his generation, and he compares them to children. He accuses them of childish behavior. This is a little bit of a footnote, but in Jesus' day, children played particular games. Two of them were called weddings and funerals. And that's what this first section makes reference to. The game of weddings involved flute playing and dancing, while the game of funerals included wailing and mourning. Neither one of those games strikes me as competitive with stickball, but anyway, those are the two games. And Jesus says the Jews are like these children, not agreeing on which game to play. One group wants to play weddings with the flutes and whatnot, and the other group wants to play funerals. The comparison Jesus is drawing is with the disagreement at that time among the Jews, the very real disagreement over who to follow, John the Baptist or Jesus. John, you remember, came to us dressed in camel's hair, and he didn't drink or socialize the way Jesus did, and his diet was locusts and honey. The result was that some people quite rightly found John authentic and charismatic, and they followed him. They followed John. Jesus himself said, "Truly I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John." Other people dismissed John as just being possessed of a demon. Jesus also had his detractors who said that he ate and drank, so he must be a glutton and a drunkard. That's what this morning's gospel refers to. And plus, he was friends with tax collectors and sinners, so he was probably not somebody to follow. But, of course, Jesus had great crowds of followers. And so there were these two opposing factions, the John group and the Jesus group. And this morning, Jesus is calling that behavior childish. Jesus' message here seems to be that he wished they could find a way to push past their divisions. He wishes they could judge on the basis of deeds. The parallel with our country today is obvious. One group can hardly associate with the other without the occasion erupting in hostility. Maybe an asteroid hurtling toward Earth, or maybe an alien invasion, will bring us to our senses and free us to get past our grievance and our anger and rise above our differences. So far, we know that not even a virulent epidemic has been enough to bring us to that place. How will we ever get to that place? How will we get there? Jesus today sounds as if he's being hard on children. But we know that Jesus feels quite the opposite about children. This morning's gospel is really an outlier. Jesus feels quite the opposite about children. We remember that Jesus elsewhere in the gospels recommended childlike behavior. He praised children as good examples of the greatest of all virtues, which is humility. Jesus says later in Matthew, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." And then Jesus says, "Let the little children come unto me, and forbid them not, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of heaven belongs." And we have all observed that left to themselves, children can get along beautifully. It will be a challenge. I know it will be very difficult for me to put away my anger. But that kind of innocence, that childlike innocence and natural benevolence and generosity of spirit, that humility will be our only salvation. our second section today, which is equally obscure. Ends with, to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Here in this piece, Jesus thanks the Father that he has revealed himself not to the wise and the intelligent, but to those he calls infants. The message here might be that God's truth is not something that can be found out. It is something that is revealed. God is hidden from those who try to come at him or her with their learning. God is revealed to the innocent. God is not a rational construct or the result of a thought process or something to be conceived of or understood. God is an event. God is experienced. God is an experience. God is reacted to. God is revealed. And the way we know him is through his Son. And Jesus says, to receive his truth, we must be humble as infants. So we come back to humility. Back to humility. Jesus is always loving the lowly and the poor and the suffering and the innocent. And he saves his harshest criticism for the pious and the proud and the high and mighty. He saves his angriest words for those. I have cited it before, but it's one of my favorite parables. It's only in Luke. The parable of the two men, a Pharisee and a tax collector, who went up to the temple to pray. And one of them confidently came forward and said, "Thank you, God, that I am not like other people." And he was proud. He was saying to God, "I'm here, so we're good." The other man came to the temple and didn't even look up. He hung back and said, "God, I am a sinner, be merciful." Jesus loves us all the time, unconditionally, everybody, but he prefers the humble. He approves of the man at the back. Humility is that greatest and first Christian virtue, while pride is the original sin. Pride is what separates us from the love of God. The proud man just doesn't get Christianity and never will. He doesn't get the essence of it, which is to be unpretentious and open and repentant and loving and caring. Humility is not to be mistaken for timidity. I said it last week, but I will repeat it. The most frequent teaching in the Gospels is some version of, "Fear not, have no fear, do not be afraid." From the Nativity story right through the resurrection, either Jesus says it or an angel shows up to say it, "Do not be afraid." So, the ideal is a combination of humility and courage. Humility and courage. Both. But how do we get that? I believe we can get there, get to that place of true confidence through what we call the peace of God. The peace of God, that state of inner serenity and calm that keeps our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son. Which brings us to our last section this morning. It is the one that has, in my opinion, only one correct translation, the King James Version. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. There's a certain sequence to this morning's gospel. It reminds me of some of the Psalms. In a number of the Psalms, we start out on a sad, plaintive note. Like, how long, O Lord? How long will we suffer? And by the end of the psalm, there is an expression of confidence and praise and thanksgiving, sometimes rejoicing. And this morning's gospel is maybe like that. We start out with our Lord being frustrated and critical. And we end with this profound expression of welcoming. By the time we get to this third section, there's no more chastising, no more teaching. Just come unto me, I will refresh you. So we end with a promise. We end with a blessing, and we need it. Many of us are just weary. We're worn down from carrying our burdens of illness, or loneliness, or separation, or the never-ending concern about money, or our sense of injustice and wrongness. Wherever we look, we see just pervasive wrongness. So we might feel an anxious fear or a sadness of heart, or we're just worn out. And then Jesus says, I will give you rest. I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Another word for rest is refreshment. Or we might say peace or love, a calming of heart and soul. Whatever we call it, it is God's blessing on us. We are welcomed. We are loved. God be praised. Love your neighbor. Amen.
Amen.
I would ask, please, for that we take a moment before the Nicene Creed. stand, please, and say together on page 326. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our prayers of the people this morning can be found in the prayer book on page 328. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications, and to give thanks for all men. Receive these our prayers, which we offer in divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church through the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, who all bishops and other ministers remember, especially our diocesan bishops and clergy and Father Chris, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, remembering especially our federal government and our state government, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions, welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee above thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who suffer from the present pandemic, and all those who care for them, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service. Grant us so to follow the good example of St. Paul and St. John and all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Amen. Let us say together, please, at the top of page 331, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and beware our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We're joined this morning by Andrea Bargabos. Andrea Bargabos comes to us through a couple of different ways. A friend who is the music department head at Salisbury School. Andrea also happens to be a friend and associate of Donald Sosin. She has quite a long list of accomplishments. We're very lucky and grateful to have Andrea with us this morning. We give thee but thine own, whatever the gift may be.
Thank you.
prepare on page 333, please. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, according to whose true promise the Holy Ghost came down from heaven, lighting upon the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to thy church the power to serve thee as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dear and beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we thy humble servants do celebrate and live here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body, blood. earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. Let us say together, Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself and take the form of a servant, and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the will to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We will conclude, please, with hymn 719. 719.
Thanks be to God.